all retro looking today because this is Heritage Sunday at New Hope. We have celebrated Heritage Sunday for quite a few years now. The first Sunday after Labor Day, a day to remember our nearly two centuries together as a congregation. Not all of us have been here that long, but that's how long the church has been around. And rather than do announcements, I don't really have any. I thought instead I would read from the initial entry in our record book. And we're fortunate enough to have the minutes of the first few years of the church in our collection. So it's kind of fascinating. But this is the original entry. It says, "A convention was holden, a convention was held at Peter Troutman's on the Driftwood River, Bartholomew County, State of Indiana, April the 26th, 1823. Peter Troutman, I believe the family name is on one of the stained glass windows inside the old chapel. And his place, the Troutman place, is supposed to have been where Millrace Park is today. So in that area is where the first New Hope gathering took place. It says, composed of baptized believers from different churches for the purpose of taking into consideration the propriety of constituting a church in this section of the country. The convention was organized by appointing Brother Joseph Fassett, moderator, and Archibald Cosby, scribe, or he was the secretary. Brother Fassett prayed. After mature deliberation, it is unanimously agreed that we form ourselves into a church state, sanctioning and subscribing to the following articles of faith and covenant." And what follows then are nine articles of faith, sort of with a Baptist flavor to them. There's more on that in the sermon later. And then there's a church covenant at the end, which says, "We do now, in the presence of the great God and before angels and men, give up ourselves to the Lord Jehovah, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and receive him this day to be our God, our Father, and Redeemer, to bring us to eternal blessedness. We likewise give up ourselves to one another by the will of God, promising to conduct towards each as brethren in Christ, watching over each other in the love of God, watching not only against the grossest evils, but against foolish jesting and words that gender strife and whatsoever else is contrary to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, promising to walk in all the commandments and ordinances of the gospel, so far as we do know, or shall have the same made known to us, believing it to be the duty of heads of families who profess the name of Christ." So there you go. That's how New Hope started.
Lord, I thank you for another chance to come together as a community. I thank you for your love and how you bring us all together under you. I pray that as times get hard and things continue to be weird, that we can let your love and your grace and your patience endure. That you can encourage us, you can love us, you can help us to look more like you. I pray that as we listen and as we worship, that we can be participating in you and your creation. I pray that as we go about this week, we end up looking more like you. I thank you, love you, and pray this all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
the crushing, in the pressing, you are making no eyes. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking no crown. So I yield to you and to your careful hand. When I trust you, I don't need to understand. Make me your vessel. In the pressing, you are making light. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking.
Chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. As a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all.
Well, I'm going to read our gospel reading because I sent the wrong thing to Kendra. And I don't have the heart to make a second request. This comes from Jesus' long prayer in John, the Gospel of John, chapter 17. And I'm going to begin with in verse 20. Jesus says, "My prayer is not for them alone." And he has been praying previously to this for his immediate disciples, his followers of that day. He says, "I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, may they be brought to complete unity, to let the world know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me." That's the word of the Lord.
I thought I'd do the sermon from here today with the cemetery in the background to remind us that we didn't get here by ourselves. There's a whole train of saints that have helped turn us into who we are. We don't do life on our own. No person is completely self-made. We're made with other people. Since it's Heritage Sunday, I thought I'd also do a sermon that will help you understand who we, New Hope, have been, how we got here. And let me start with some questions. How many of you have ever been in an exchange that went something like this? Somebody asks, "Where do you go to church?" And you say, "New Hope." And they say, "Well, what kind of a church is that?" And you say, "Well, it's New Hope Christian Church." And they say, "Well, of course it's a Christian church, but what kind of a Christian church?" And you say, "It's just a Christian church." And they say, "Yeah, of course it's just a Christian church, but what kind of denomination is it?" And you say, "It's non-denominational." And they say, "Okay, then what kind of non-denominational denomination is it? Is it like Southern Baptist Community Church, non-denominational, something like that, or something else?" How many of you have been in an exchange that went something like that? How many of you have looked up Christian churches, Churches of Christ, on the internet just to find out what you were a part of? How many of you know the names Thomas and Alexander Campbell? How many of you know have heard the name Barton Stone? Does that ring a bell? And one more thing that I'm curious about. Have any of you ever been called a Campbellite, which is a slightly mocking name for our kind of a fellowship? On this Heritage Sunday, I want to speak to you no good bunch of Campbellites. Campbellites, at least through your association with this 197-year-old congregation. As you heard earlier, this congregation was chartered at a meeting on the banks of the Driftwood River in 1823. A group of people determined to found a worshiping body on what at that time was frontier territory. The congregation started out basically as a Baptist church, New Hope Baptized Church, and was connected to the area Baptist Association that was headquartered in Flat Rock. Our original articles of faith had sort of a Baptist flavor to them, and there were monthly business meetings at the church to fulfill the requirements of the association. But it turns out New Hope was a troublemaking Baptist church. that soon drifted out from under that umbrella. Within a few years of its founding, the congregation dropped its articles of faith statement and named the New Testament alone as its constitution. It was formally dropped from the Flat Rock Association in 1832, so 9 years after its founding. And a quick glance through the record book makes it obvious why that exit happened. New Hope's people were getting caught up in an American Reformation movement that would eventually be labeled the Restoration Movement. A restoration in the sense of attempting to restore early church practice on the basis of scripture alone and apart from human creeds. Churches caught up in that movement practiced what they thought the New Testament taught: immersion of believers and weekly Lord's Supper. They dropped all their labels except for the label Christians, Christian Church, or Church of Christ. And they adopted Bible-focused labels or slogans like, where the scriptures speak, we speak. Where scriptures are silent, we are silent. And this is on one of the tombstones of a relative of Kathleen Smith right behind me. But here in the New Hope Cemetery, on one stone, it says, the Bible is our only rule of faith and practice. Another early Restoration slogan. New Hope's pioneers not only bought into this new Christian church movement, but they took a lead in advancing it in this area. Joseph Fassett, New Hope's first preacher, was a well-known spokesperson for the movement, a sometime key speaker at Christian church gatherings in the area. He was at a famous gathering in 1833 in Martinsville, which sort of launched the Christian church movement in this area. Leaders of New Hope helped found Northwestern Christian University, which would later become Butler University, named after Ovid Butler, a lawyer, publisher, abolitionist, and a famous Restoration preacher. Although this congregation has morphed through the centuries, today's New Hope has grown out of these roots. Now, this heritage of ours is by no means flawless, as I will point out in a minute, but at least to me, it remains a good, well-intentioned, and even fairly flexible tradition to work from. Thus me, I still associate myself with it, and I assume that you do too in some way or another because you are here and a part of things. For those of you who don't know what this tradition is all about, let me describe it positively in a three-part statement. The movement from which New Hope derives has emphasized this: unity in truth for the sake of the world. Three parts: unity in truth for the sake of the world. Our movement started above all as a unity movement. What has sometimes been labeled the original American ecumenical movement. I'll tell you a famous story from our past. At the beginning of the 19th century, 1807, a Presbyterian clergyman, Thomas Campbell, came to America from Ireland and with his family settled in western Pennsylvania. When he came to frontier America, he expected to find it a less contentious religious environment than what he'd left behind in Europe. officially, Pastor Campbell was not just a Presbyterian. He had been ordained as an Old Light, Anti-Burger, Seceder Presbyterian. Three splits in that name. And he thought surely those kinds of divisions would not continue in America, where some of the splits didn't even apply. It wasn't the same political environment. So how can anti-burger and burger apply here in the United States? But lo and behold, what he discovered was this. The American church was even more stubbornly divided than the European church. And he concluded, this isn't right. What a horrible witness this is to the world. Christ intends the church to be one. Thus, Jesus' words in John 17, the prayer that was read earlier, or our Ephesians passage from Paul, where he pleads for all to be one. And Campbell said, I'm done with these man-made creeds that divide us. I'm done with all the labels. From now on, I'm no longer Presbyterian. I'm just a Christian. And I'm going to associate with any other believer who wants to associate with me. And so he did just that. He started connecting with Presbyterians and Methodists and Baptists and Episcopalians and began having independent Bible studies and even independent worship services because he had changed. Meanwhile, I didn't mention, but his oldest son, Alexander, had been left behind at Thomas Campbell's alma mater, the University of Glasgow in Scotland. And Alexander there was training for ministry. And Alexander was going through some searchings of his own. He had come under the influence of some of the free-thinking philosophers of the Enlightenment, like John Locke and Thomas Reed there at the university, and he was developing some independent, and you might say, anti-establishment ideas. When he was 21, the Presbyterian Church of Glasgow, of which he was a member, was preparing to hold one of its semi-annual communion services, and a part of that process was for the elders of the church to go out and visit the members of the church and examine them in order to determine who was worthy of receiving communion. If you were deemed worthy during that examination, then you received a token, a little lead piece, that would admit you to the communion service. And Alexander thought that was just a horrible practice, that a clergyman would sit in judgment on somebody else and could even bar a child of God from the Lord's Supper. Well, Alexander passed his exam and received his token, but then at the actual communion service, he had this moment of conscience. When the plate came around for the tokens, he dropped his token into the plate. But when the bread and the wine were passed, he didn't partake of them. And he just walked out of the service. I'm done with denominations that fence people off from the table. Well, shortly after that, he headed back to America to join his family, and as they prepared to meet, father and son, I can imagine anxiety in both of them. How is the father to tell the son that he has renounced his own ordination and determined to associate freely and preach freely to whosoever will? And how will the son tell his dad that he can't take any more of these denominational fences that keep God's people apart? Well, without knowing it, the two of them had come to similar conclusions. And after their meeting, which turned out to be a happy meeting, of course, they began to work together for ways to bring Christians together rather than to keep Christian people apart. it's important to know that they didn't set out to start a new church. They wanted to promote unity across denominational lines. But what happened instead was they tended to get kicked out of the churches that they tried to fellowship with. And so at that point in 1811, they began to meet as a "we are Christians only" sort of worshiping body, just a plain old Christian church, which is obviously what leads to all the questions that you have gotten. Well, what kind of a Christian church is it? That kind. So number one, unity. The second part of the formula is in truth. They thought, if we're going to bring people together, we're going to need some kind of standard upon which all the people coming together can agree upon, some kind of standard for truth. What can be that common truth? And that, of course, is where the Bible, particularly the New Testament, comes into play. Unity in the truth of Scripture. Since not all believers share the same creedal statements, their thought was, why don't you leave behind your Westminster confessions and your Heidelberg catechisms and all that? At least leave them behind as standards for everybody else. And let's try to pattern our spiritual lives together on the basis of the New Testament alone. Not that all creeds are bad. The problem, they thought, was when creeds are used to separate one group of people from another. So Christian church fellowships became Bible study forums where people searched through scripture and wrestled with biblical answers to issues and sometimes agreed to disagree. Another slogan of the movement was, in essentials unity, in opinions, liberty, in all things, love. In other words, regarding what's clear in Scripture, let's agree. Where it's not so clear, let's allow for diversity of opinion, but let's keep everything that we're doing wrapped up in love. So, again, unity in truth, the truth of Scripture. And often it's left there. Unity and truth, which of course creates a kind of tension. Which one of the two matters most? Do you sacrifice unity for what you believe to be true? Or do you give in a little on truth in order to keep everybody together? And there have been different ways of answering that during the history of the Restoration Movement. But although descriptions of the movement are often left at that, unity and truth, I think there's one more piece, very important piece, maybe critical piece, to the puzzle. The fullest summary is, as I said, unity in truth, three, for the sake of the world. Why seek a united church when a smorgasbord of options seems to suit people's tastes just fine? Why try to mash people together when maybe they're comfortably divided? Well, in Jesus' famous prayer there in John 17, he prays for those who will believe in him, and he prays for them to be one so that the world will know Jesus and know what he's all about. And what is Jesus all about? He is the Savior who comes to bring life back into creation through his ministry, tries to bring people back to their God, tries to bring people back in fellowship with each other. His ministry is a ministry of reconciliation, a ministry of making things one. And the unbelieving world looks in upon a divided church and they says, dude, you want me to join you in what you're doing when you can't even get along with each other? The reason those early pioneers strove for unity in truth was for evangelistic reasons, so that the world would see what Jesus had prayed for, a united fellowship, embodying what Jesus was all about, and demonstrating that the way to Jesus was not through a humanly created institution of some kind, but was a direct connection to Jesus. I'm going to throw in one more name, which is why the movement that New Hope comes out of is sometimes called the Stone Campbell movement. Barton Stone. Barton Stone became a Christian during his college years after hearing a Presbyterian evangelist speak, and subsequently he became a Presbyterian minister. But like the Campbells, he started to question some of the parts of Calvinism and started to drift away from Presbyterianism. And he was encouraged by a non-denominational phenomenon that was happening in frontier America, a tent revival movement that came to be known as the Second Great Awakening. One of Stone's famous revival sites was Cane Ridge, Kentucky. At these huge tent gatherings, denominational alliances didn't seem to matter much. As many as 20,000 people from all kinds of Christian fellowships would visit during the days of a revival and would hear fiery preaching, and many new believers were formed as a result of these campaigns. By the way, 20,000 people, that was like 10% of the population of Kentucky. So that gives you an idea of what kind of huge gatherings these were. I should also mention that at these meetings, there were sometimes odd charismatic manifestations like fainting and laughing, laughing in the spirit, and my favorite of all, barking like dogs. That's my favorite. I would have liked to have seen that. Well, Barton Stone, this revival preacher, eventually bumped into the Campbells, and he felt like what they were trying to do was similar to what he was trying to do, and he united his followers with theirs, and thus became the Stone Campbell movement. What's interesting is that the Campbells and the Stones disagreed on lots of doctrinal issues. But they agreed above all that division was bad. And they agreed that the Bible was the source of truth, and that despite all the differing interpretations, it was the standard for unity, and people should work toward that. And they believed in evangelism. They believed in reconciling people to God. That was job one. So it was unity and truth for the sake of the world. The tradition is not perfect. Unity? This frontier ecumenical movement has sadly, through the years, divided into three different groups itself: Churches of Christ, Christian Churches / Churches of Christ, and Disciples of Christ. I also think our founding fathers had an overly optimistic Enlightenment view of common sense reading of Scripture. It turns out, I think, that people doing honest readings of Scripture can come to all kinds of interpretations, it's not always as easy as they had imagined. Just get back and everything will make sense. Not always. It takes more work than they might have imagined to come to common understanding. And for the sake of the world, too easily churches and our tradition have turned their attention inward and lost that evangelistic zeal that they originally had, that idea that we are here not for ourselves, but we're here to bring Christ to the world. But still today, I think, on this Heritage Sunday, I would advocate these as noble sorts of goals for church. You could do worse than be a part of a congregation that shoots for that thing, unity and truth for the sake of the world.
Chases me down, fights to shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you didn't kick down, I won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Good morning. Our communion devotion today comes from Ephesians 1:3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ Jesus. Blessings pour out in our life depending on how we look at things. We can be rich in spirit, even when we are poor in money, things, and people. If you own the whole world, and if all the people loved you, yet you never stopped to count your blessings, you would be miserable. Happiness is found by seeing and appreciating the blessings of God's love and power. If you woke up this morning with more health than illness, then you are more blessed than the million who will not survive this week. If you have never experienced the danger of battle, the loneliness of imprisonment, the agony of torture, or the pangs of starvation, then you are ahead of 500 million people in the world. If you have food in the refrigerator, clothes on your back, a roof over your head, and a place to sleep, then you're richer than 75% of the world. If you have money in the bank, in your wallet, and spare change in a dish someplace, you are among the top 8% of the world's wealthy. If your parents are still alive and still married, you are very rare even in the United States. We all need to remind ourselves that everything we have, every resource we possess, and every talent we display comes from God. There's no such thing as a self-made person in the Christian world. Whatever we do, whatever we achieve, whatever ambitions we fulfill, whatever we accomplish, it all comes from God. If we forget to offer Him the glory and praise for all these benefits, then we need to ask ourselves if we really have faith in God. He is the provider of all our blessings. He is the sustainer of all that we need. Happiness with God is possible only if we look within our heart. Looking within, listening within, and speaking within is how we make contact with God. When we open our hearts and listen, we can find God telling us how much He loves us. When we are overwhelmed with thanksgiving for God's blessings within our life, we are to give thanks to God in prayer. We give thanks in prayer, we find happiness. Now we'll have our communion. When they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to them, to his disciples, saying, "Take it, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many," he said to them. "Truly I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we praise your holy name, and we thank you for your plan of salvation. We thank you for Jesus, who sacrificed his body on that cruel cross in Calvary and shed his blood for the forgiveness of our sins. We praise you and thank you for all you've given us, for the wealth that we have, for the example you gave us in your holy word. And we praise your holy name, for it's in Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.